Welcome to Bridge Bible Talk, a live call-in program where we answer your Bible questions and questions on the Christian faith. You can email your question to answers@bbtlive.org or call with your question 888-71-BRIDGE, 888-712-7434. In studio today is Pastor Robert Baltodano. Now here's your host, Rico Basso.
Good afternoon and welcome. I'm your host, Rico Basso. This is Bridge Bible Talk. We are a live call-in radio program where we answer any question you may have about the Bible or the Christian faith. So if you have a question, get on your phone, give us a call. We'd love to hear from you. 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. Or you can email us your questions at answers@bbtlive.org. That's answers@bbtlive.org. Today in the studio with me, filling in for Pastor Lloyd, Pastor Robert Baltodano.
That's right. I'm back here again on the other end, as I'm usually sitting where you're at.
Yeah.
But it's always fun to be able to do this together with you and to answer Bible questions. I love it, you know, just talk about God. For 1 hour, we get to spend the time, the privilege, really, to answer Bible questions, which is really cool.
Yeah, and it's a good thing, you know, not only for us, like, you know, obviously we enjoy it, but it's also, you know, good for everybody listening. You know, you had a question, and you can just call us, 888-712-7434. We'd love to hear from you, answer any question, like we say, about the Bible or the Christian faith. And, you know, we're also coming up close to Easter.
I know.
Right? I mean, it's coming up pretty quick. And, you know, it's always, obviously, that's, you know, it's like our, that's one of our, it's obviously one of our main celebrations in the Christian faith. And it's important to us. And, you know, even though when we talk about, like, the resurrection of Christ and all that comes with it, you know, it's something that we do celebrate, I mean, quite literally every day. But, you know, the traditions that we carry and the things that we, you know, hold to when it comes to around the actual time of Easter is always a great celebration for us here at Calvary Chapel Old Bridge, and also obviously around the country. And it's a good, good testimony.
It is. It's the, as I said, I think yesterday, it's a capstone of the Christian faith.
Yeah.
I always liked what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 when he was writing about, you know, the risen Christ and our faith in him. And I like, he said something that's pretty interesting. He said basically that if Christ hasn't risen, right? He says that we are the most, as he says, you know, our faith is futile. And he says you're still in your sins. So it's almost like we're just wasting our time and, you know, and all of this stuff if Jesus never rose again. But we know he did. He rose again on the third day. So that gives us the meaning and purpose of life. It gives us the understanding that, you know, we were sinners, and now being redeemed, we have access to Christ through the Holy Spirit, and we get to go to heaven, which is amazing.
Yeah, and without the resurrection, it is all for nothing. Mm. And we know that, you know, basically our entire faith, like you mentioned there, Pastor Robert, is the whole faith hinges upon, you know, the fact that Christ is alive.
Amen.
And he's going to return. 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. We're here live in the studio, Pastor Robert Baltodano, and we're answering questions about the Bible or the Christian faith. Also want to give a shout out to those of you who are watching us on social media platforms, Facebook and YouTube. And you too can get in on the action, drop in a question in the comments section, and we will answer it live on air. And you can put that in the comments section. And then while you're there, drop a like, and you know, maybe share the program on the platform that you're watching it, so we can get the algorithms going, and other people can get a hold of Bridge Bible Talk that maybe haven't heard it before. So we're going to jump right in, Pastor Robert, as we got some email questions, and we will head to our email question here to Ray Ann from New Jersey, who asks about Matthew 3:17. And Rayanne asks that, when it says, and a voice from heaven said, this is my son, whom I love, with whom I am well pleased, why aren't these words in red, like when Jesus speaks? I have wondered this quite a bit.
Well, there are no red letters in the original, you know, Greek manuscripts. And most importantly, the red letters do not give Christ's spoken words any more weight or worth than all the other words in the Bible, because we have to remember that all scripture from Genesis to Revelation is inspired. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. This whole red letter, you know, came about, you know, by a man by the name of Louis Klopsch, I believe, 1899. He published the first red letter New Testament, just to point out the words of Jesus. And so when we open our Bibles, we see red letters, we know that's Christ speaking. God spoke too, obviously, right? First person of the Trinity. And even though they're not in red letters, it doesn't mean that God didn't speak. It's just, again, red letters is more of a tradition that was in place by this man by the name of Lewis. So I wouldn't worry about that. I don't know. What do you think, Rico?
No, yeah. And, you know, and it, like you mentioned, I mean, you know, all scripture is given, you know, it's inspired by God. And it doesn't make the color of the ink doesn't add more, you know, mm-hmm. weight to what you're reading in the text. In fact, there's, you know, Bibles before then, they weren't in red letter. And
right.
so it said essentially the same thing.
Yeah.
But the reason I think specifically there is because, right, Ryan, you might be referring to, you know, well, if the Father said it, it's the same as Jesus saying it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a yes and a no. It's yes that God is saying it, but it's definitely a no that when the Father says something, it's not Christ saying it. Because
mm-hmm.
they're, you know, three distinct persons mm-hmm. in the Trinity. And, you know, the Father is not the Son, and the Son is not the Father. So in the text, if that's the question,
mm-hmm.
you know, I think that's the answer that you want to go with there, that they're not the same. So it's not going to be
right.
the same.
Good point.
888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. You can email us your questions, answers@bbtlive.org. That's answers@bbtlive.org. Another quick question here from Lisa that we got through email. And Lisa just asked, why did Jesus tell the demons to be quiet or silent about who he was?
That question comes up a lot, Rico.
Yeah.
The veiling of Christ's identity is what's taking place. Also had a lot to do with the concern for timing, you know, for the time of Jesus being revealed as the Messiah. As news spread about him and throughout the crowds, you know, the crowds grew larger and it became more difficult for Jesus to minister to individuals. I think another motive, too, is for concealing his identity may have been in part to avoid the violent political uprising early in his ministry. They were expecting a Messiah that would come in more as a political deliverer to get him out of the hands of the Roman government, which was very oppressive. They looked at Jesus as that when he came through, right, the Palm Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Hosanna, Hosanna, he's coming, but he's riding on a colt, right, a donkey, a lowly animal, not a horse, a white horse walking through. So I think a lot of that had to do with that, and he didn't really need the testimony of demons either.
Mm.
He came here to reveal himself, and he did not need the help of a demon, so he shut him up.
And it's kind of funny, too, because I always think that whenever he told somebody in the scriptures to not tell other people about him, inevitably
they did. Yeah,
so,
it's true.
So sometimes you wonder if he was saying it knowing that they were gonna go and share it anyway.
Right. But good question though.
Yeah, that is a good question. And you know, God's timing is always perfect, and that's the same thing in the life of Christ. So it was his time to reveal who he was going, you know, the things that he would do and say, and you know, the miracles that he would do.
And isn't that like life too? I mean, if you think about this, if you apply this to our personal life, there are times that God will speak to our hearts about something, but we sense by the Holy Spirit not to tell people yet, don't say anything yet. And it's something that we're dealing with the Lord ourselves, whether it's a transition, whether it's something that God wants us to do, but it's not time yet to say anything to anyone. And so God uses that too for in our lives as well to kind of reveal things to us, but then at the same time say, hey, just don't say anything. So you stay quiet, right, until the Lord gives you that permission or the freedom to speak. Of course, I'm not, you know, this is not the same as what he was doing with the demons. The demons were more of just trying to distract the crowds, and they would love to, you know, make things worse for Jesus. So that's why he gave them that command, don't say anything.
Hmm. You're listening to Bridge Bible Talk, 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. We're here live in the studio answering any question you might have about the Christian faith or about the Bible. So give us a call, 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. Let's take a look at our social media page here, Pastor Robert. On Facebook, Anne Marie leaves us a question. Says, what's your thoughts? I noticed on Facebook a lot of Christians post birthday greetings to people that have passed away on their Facebook page.
Yeah, I see that a lot.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen that on my Facebook page as well. When it's the anniversary or it's a birthday, they would say, you know, there's things that, you know, they'd say something like, my mom would have been 55 today or 64 today. Happy birthday, Mom.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about that. I mean, I just think that's just part of the grieving process. It's a memory. As long as they're not trying to tap into that dead person and trying to bring them back, or my mom said this, or Mom, if you hear me, then you get a little bit more concern about it. But I don't know. I mean, what do you think?
I agree. I think generally it's, you're paying homage to someone in your family that you love very much. Mm-hmm. I mean, as long as you know that, yeah, you're not, you know, they're not reading the post. You're not mm-hmm. actually talking to them. You know, commemoration is a nice heartfelt thing and a
yeah.
sweet thing. I think you said it right. Part of the grieving process.
Yeah, because, I mean, if you think about it, I mean, what are you going to do? You're going to comment on that post and say, your mom's dead, and so why are you celebrating a birthday? They're not celebrating birthdays in heaven.
Right.
I mean, then you become insensitive.
Yeah.
So you don't want to split hairs
yeah.
over a situation like that, unless it's something that is posted that has spiritual implication, where it's there. My mom told me, or my mom spoke to me last night. Then
yeah.
you can, even that, you have to go aside and maybe private message them. Hey, can we talk about that?
Yeah, you know? I agree. I think that you can run into some issues there if you're, you know, it's important to be able to connect with people, you know, obviously generally as Christians, we want to share the gospel
yeah.
and have room for that. But, you know, you really want to be able to read the room, you know,
mm-hmm.
know the temperature in the room.
Yeah.
Like this could, you know, this person might not be conducting a seance on Facebook. They might just be commemorating
yeah.
A life that was lived. 888-712-7434. We're going to go out to the lines to Queens. Robert, you are on the air.
Yes, thank you for taking my call. Yes, I know we always say Happy Easter, but I don't think Easter is mentioned in the New Testament anywhere. Where did that word Easter come from?
Yeah, there's a lot of things in Scripture that it's not mentioned. You know, Christmas, birthdays, and we do those celebrations. Easter, obviously, Easter is celebrated. For us, it's the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And, you know, the origin of it when it comes to the background, you know, Ishtar and the goddess of fertility, a lot of that has pagan origin, if you will, you know, connections. And this is all pre-Christian pagan traditions. The timing of Easter, for example, coincides with the arrival of the spring. And many cultures celebrate the arrival of spring as a time of renewal, growth, and fertility. And so it some obviously take it to that extent. And it comes to that kind of worship, if you will. We don't do that, obviously, but we celebrate the resurrection of Christ. Some of the symbols and customs associated with Easter that we all are aware of, eggs and rabbits, you know, they do have roots in pagan tradition. The egg, for example, are often used as symbols of fertility, rebirth. So, again, when it comes to those things, we can change it to counter that type of paganism, if you will. If some kids will have, you know, Easter egg hunts and they put Bible verses in the egg to evangelize the children. There's ways that you can do it, just like we do with Christmas. We do that as well. You know, when we look at the birth of Jesus Christ, we're not celebrating, you know, Christmas trees and all of that stuff that comes with it. But we focus on the birth of Jesus. So we want to make a big deal about it. You know, the resurrection of Christ. So we don't want to stay quiet. But like you said earlier, when we started the program, we don't just celebrate it just once a year. We should always celebrate it every week. I mean, we should always tell people about Christ and what he did on the cross and what happened on the third day.
Yeah, that's a good point there, Pastor Robert. Robert, did that answer your question?
Yes, it did, sir. Thank you very much.
All right. Mm-hmm. Thanks for the call. You know, one of the things, too, that we always hear about, you know, about that, and that's, we get the same kind of questions for Christmas. And fair question, right? Because you always want to investigate what it is that you're doing. Why do we do this particular tradition? There's not much history on Easter being linked with paganism.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not really there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's got a much longer and rooted tradition in Christendom than it does anything
yeah.
else. So I know people look at, there's the word Easter is in the New Testament, but out of, you know, it's a different context, the same thing.
Right. That's a good point.
But yeah, that's a good call there, Robert. Thank you for that. 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. We'd love to hear from you answering questions about the Bible or the Christian faith. We're going to go out to Long Island to Ubani.
Yeah, hello, hi.
How you doing?
Thank you for taking this call. I was listening to the program yesterday, and somebody asked about losing your salvation. And the pastor responded that there's nothing you can do to lose your salvation. So I wanted him to throw some more light, because I believe that our belief in the death of Jesus Christ gives us salvation. And I also think that any point in time you reject that, it means you have lost your salvation. So when you say there's nothing you can do to lose your salvation, does it include the sin of rejecting the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary? Does it include that if you reject that, are you still saved?
Good question.
Okay, so let's think about this first of all. When we say, can you lose your salvation, this is what we're saying. We're saying that we can become unsealed, unredeemed, unborn again, and God basically undoes everything. When we say lose your salvation, because if somebody who is born again becomes born again of the Holy Spirit enters in. Ephesians chapter 1 says, Paul says that you are sealed with the Holy Spirit. And then Romans says that we've been justified by faith. And he talks a lot about that. And we've been redeemed, bought back. So now to undo all of that, that means that God returns us, right? It's like when you buy a product at the store, you own it, you keep it. You know what? I don't really like this product. I still have my receipt. I'm going to go back and return it, and you get your money back. And so when we talk about losing your salvation, we're actually talking about all of those components, all those things that will actually take place. So to the question is, if somebody rejects all of a sudden in the middle of so-called being born again, my conclusion is that perhaps they really weren't saved. They did not really know Jesus Christ. Can they walk away from Jesus? Absolutely. There's been many times that you see, even Israel was considered a backslidden Israel. They backslid. They turned their backs on God in the sense of doing their thing, rebelling and whatnot, but they were always God's people, God's chosen people, and he was faithful to them. So when it comes to the Christian walk, can a Christian turn his back on God and say, hi, I just, you know, right now I'm just going to do my thing? Yeah. And then you go to Hebrews chapter 12, and we're talking about then God as children chastens us because we're not left alone. He loves us, and so he goes after us. And so you have Jonah as a good example who chose to say no to God. He turned his back on God in that sense. He didn't want to follow him or listen to what God told him to do. God went after him. You know the story. It was a fish. Fish spit him out. It was a storm before that. And so, again, when it comes to that question, can you lose your salvation, I have a hard time believing that a genuine born-again believer can become undone in that sense. I kind of said it more in a practical way. I can give you Bible verses as well, but you know what I'm saying, Ubani?
Ubani?
Yeah, I get what you're saying. I get what you're saying, because you just said that, you know, anyone in that position means that he did not in the first instance receive salvation. That's what you're saying, right?
Exactly. Exactly. Okay. Because salvation is not yours. Salvation is God's. God saved you. And so salvation is such an incredible transaction that takes place. And we, for God to say, here's the salvation that you have, that I've given you, you hold on to it, you take care of it, it's all on you now, we'd lose it. We are frail people, and we need the Holy Spirit inside of us to help us live that Christian life, to keep us in check, if you will. When we sin, we blow it as a believer. We get conviction. We get convicted. We can give pain to the Holy Spirit, you know, birth pangs, as it says, or we can grieve the Holy Spirit. But, you know, if, and I know this goes back to some of the Hillsong worship leader who was a Christian and all of a sudden says, oh, I'm not a believer anymore. You have even one of the DC Talk groups, right? You have, you know, Toby Mac still following the Lord, and so is, who's the other one? Michael Tate. But then you have Kevin Max, who decided to say, I'm redefining my faith, and he's now more of an agnostic. Joshua Harris, I listened to him teach. He had books, Kissing, Dating, Goodbye. All of a sudden he says, I'm no longer a Christian. And so those situations, I have no idea. I can't even explain those situations. All I say is these guys better know the Lord, because if they never did, then they were just playing the game. You know, they were celebrities. They were playing the game. But my thought is, you know what? They're probably children of God, and God will get to them. Because if they are children, God will bring them back. They might be going through a hard time right now, and you pray for them. But those situations are hard to understand, because it's the heart. And I don't know the heart. I don't see the heart of man, but God does.
Does that help you out, Ubani?
Yeah, I think you nailed it, sir. I appreciate your explanation. Thank you.
All right. God bless. Thanks for the call.
I mean, you probably had those situations, right? Somebody of comes course. To you and says, I feel like I lost my salvation, and, you know.
Yeah, it's, you know, I think that when you're, just to tie, so to tie some scriptures in to with what,
yes,
what
please,
we're saying,
thank you.
Right? There's two of them that call to mind. The first one, that, and you mentioned it without mentioning it, was Romans 8:30. That those who he predestined, he also called. Those who he called, he justified. Those who he justified, he also glorified. So if you're losing your salvation, quote unquote, right? I'm using air quotes. Mm-hmm. How are you undoing all that? You know, how are you undoing the call of God? How are you undoing the justification, the glorification? How do you undo those things? Mm-hmm. Because when you're a Christian, you know, God is talking about you here, and then that would mean that he'd have to uproot, you know, this chain of salvation here. But then also to the Obani's point there about somebody who will say, I always go to 1 Corinthians 12:3, and it says this, it says, therefore I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, you can get people who just, well, Jesus is Lord, and just say it kind of But the verse is saying here is that a heartfelt, honest, genuine confession that Christ is Lord, you know, that, in other words, Christ is God, Christ is the Savior, you know, all things encompassing Christ. You can literally only say that if you have the Holy Spirit in you.
Mm-hmm.
And then for you to be able to say, you know, Christ is no longer these things, this verse is saying that you don't have the Holy Spirit,
mm-hmm.
because you wouldn't be able to say these things, you know, either way, with or without the Spirit. Without the Spirit, you can't say it and confess it and mean it. With the Spirit, you can't not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so to your point, the tough part is kind of watching the thing play out.
Yeah.
Because, you know, these guys that you mentioned, all these guys, are sad stories right now in this space.
Right.
But, you know, however it ends up, mm-hmm. it's like, oh, okay, well, they backslid, or, oh, they were in a tough spot. How do you explain that? But, you know, if they continue on in their life like this and their life ends like this, you know, now you got there, and there's a lot of questions. And it throws people off.
Right.
You know, but, you know, there's really a handful of Bible verses you talk about. You know, did they finish the race? Are they finishing the race? Are they bearing the fruit?
You know. And God is a covenant keeper.
Right.
Right. He did that with the in the Old Testament. He kept the covenant. He promised to the Israelites, and even to this day, he's still keeping that covenant. That's why he's protected this nation for so many centuries, right? And so we've entered into a covenant with Christ as well, a new covenant, obviously. And so we look at him as a covenant keeper. And even the Bible says, even when we are faithless, God remains faithful, right? Because he cannot deny himself. And so that's one part of God that, you know, in his essence, his attribute is he's not flaky like we are.
Right. He that began a good work in you,
he will complete it. Yeah.
And that's the key. Yeah, absolutely. That's a good call. And, you know, it's important. And, you know, I think if you're listening and you struggle with this, you know, even on the other end, am I a Christian? Because then you start to look really deeply at your fruit, or you look at your growth.
Mm-hmm.
Am I a Christian? Do I love the Lord like a Christian would love the Lord? And you can get down that And, you know, honestly, sometimes that's healthy. It's an introspection. You're looking at yourself. You're looking at your faith. You're looking at the fruits, and you're asking yourself, am I a Christian? I always find that people who, you know, perhaps are not or quote-unquote walk away are ones that were never really worried about that.
Yeah.
You know, it never really hit.
It's true.
888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. You're listening to Bridge Bible Talk. I'm your host, Rico Basso, and live in the studio with me today, Pastor Robert Baltodano, and we are answering any question that you might have about the Bible or the Christian faith. So get on the phone. Give us a call. We'd love to hear from you. 888-712-7434. I got another question from social media from Kim. And Kim on Facebook just simply asks, could you explain what a prophet is in today's culture?
Prophets in today's culture? Mm-hmm. Well, there's no prophets like the Old Testament.
All right.
Obviously, you know, we see very clearly that the last prophet that came to this earth was really John the Baptist. You know, Jesus himself was, you know, also one who spoke for God. Hebrews 1:1 tells us that God spoke, you know, in times past to the fathers through the prophets in various times, various ways, but has spoken to us by his Son. Today, when it comes to prophets, the word prophets, it's not foretelling, but more forthtelling. And so it's teaching, bringing forth the word. Paul talks about this in Ephesians chapter 4, that he's given some to be, you know, prophets, pastors, teachers, whatnot. And, you know, I might have messed up the order. But the word, when you define prophet, is speaking about or talking about the forth, bringing forth the word of God. And so that's where you could see today, because there's an abuse, right, Rico, mm-hmm. today in some churches where they call the pastor, oh, this is Prophet Michael, you know, and so they become this authoritative kind of figure that you don't question them if they're given this revelation to you that you're like, says, well, don't question God's anointed, right?
Yeah, and you know what? I don't find anywhere in the New Testament that reclassifies a prophet. So to me, it's sort of the same standards that we had in the Old Testament. So, you know, if you're claiming to be a prophet, you better be able to stack up to all of the things that were laid out in the Old Covenant, because there's no redefinition in the New, nowhere. Not to dismiss it, but if that's going to be the claim, then, you know, you better have some substantial backing that would have been expected and uphold to it.
Well, absolutely, especially when the consequences for being a false prophet in the Old Testament, speaking of stack, and they stack rocks to kill you.
That would be it.
Yeah. So you got to be careful when people say, you know, thus says the Lord, or God told me this. You better know God told you that.
That's right. Don't take that lightly.
No.
Don't use that term lightly. 888-712-7434. Pastor Robert, we had a call earlier that got dropped from Amber from Utah. And she asked, a married couple who is walking with the Lord now, but were not before they were married, how do they witness to people who knew them before they walked with the Lord and now after?
Well, that's the whole thing about being a witness. Now mm-hmm. that they are Christians, people know or knew them who they were before, whatever that was like. Maybe they were, you know, totally off and pagans or whatever. Now they can say, hey, we're believers in Christ. And to witness that new life in Christ, that's how you do it. Simply just show that new life that Christ has given you, and you share the gospel with those, even if people are in awe, saying, wait a minute, you're not doing drugs anymore? I mean, I sold drugs to you, you know? And, well, not anymore. We're in Christ now. And let me tell you, you know, that what we were doing was very destructive. And if it wasn't for Christ, you know, we wouldn't be here today. So we want to offer that gospel to you, that if you believe, you'll be saved and you can have that life that we have. I mean, it's pretty practical, right?
Oh, yeah. And, you know, the thing, when you see this new life, I think people sometimes get discouraged because it's like, well, they knew me before.
Yeah.
And so it's going to be awkward. I mean, I got news for you. It's going to be awkward no matter what.
Right.
Anytime you bring up these things, spiritual talk, you know, being reborn by God, all mm-hmm. these things are kind of uncomfortable. But the reality is it's going to be uncomfortable either way. And I understand the whole, you know, prophet has no honor in his own home. You know, people may look at you and still, but the reality is you're a new person.
Yeah.
And so walk in that, and that light will shine.
Amen.
We're going to take a quick break. Hang on the line. We see your calls. We're going to get back to you once we get back. We'll be right back.
Bridge Bible Talk. For your Bible questions and questions on the Christian faith, call now, 888-71-BRIDGE, 888-7434. We'll be right back.
Probably the greatest thing that you can do to hear from God is to actually, number one, get away, find a place, even if it's a closet or a bathroom, or climb a tree, my friend. Open up the Bible and read it. For example, go to John's Gospel and start reading it slowly, not speed reading, but slowly, and listen for God to speak. I can't quite explain it, but he will lift a verse, he will lift a statement, a sentence from his Bible off the page, as it were, and it will spark in your heart and mind, and it will very, very accurately answer the very thing you're seeking God about. God wants to speak to you. He said he does. So the best thing to do is let him speak through the pages of his Bible.
Real Life Radio with Pastor Jack Hibbs. To learn more about this ministry, go to jackhibbs.com. That's jackhibbs.com.
Hi, I'm Johnny Erickson Tata. And I remember one night when my friend Judy and I were having dinner, and she picked up a leftover lobster shell to examine it. And it was amazing. The perfect little patterns on the tail of the lobster, all these tiny half circles and exact little rows, even the way the prickly, minute feathers at the base of the tail fanned out. Wow, she said, God did that. Maybe you are thinking, Johnny, okay, sure, God did that, but that's no reason to get all excited. I mean, it was just a half-eaten lobster. I say, yes, it is reason to be excited. Nehemiah chapter 9 says, you, God, made the heavens, all their host, the earth and all that is in it, the seas and all that is in them. Oh, friend, if the heavens declare the glory of God, who created them, as well as rocks and ants and lobsters, then you should too. So next time, take a closer look at your broccoli on your plate, or your artichoke, or your kale, and remember, God did that.
This is Ann Graham Lotz with Daily Light for Daily Living. In olden days, a seal was a picture or a symbol or a writing of some type that was carved into a hard surface of metal or stone. When pressed into clay or wax, the seal left an impression that was commonly attached to documents to convey their authenticity, authority, or ownership. The Apostle Paul stated in Ephesians 1:13, having believed, you are marked in him with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the seal, guarantees that we belong to God. It's the divine proof of purchase. The seal apparently is also visible in the unseen world because it identifies us throughout the universe as authentic children of God. Listen to me. Have you ever doubted your salvation? When the enemy hisses his insidious accusations against you, God dismisses him because God knows you are his. The Holy Spirit is God's proof of ownership in your life.
Welcome back to Bridge Bible Talk. Call now with your Bible questions. 888-71-BRIDGE. 888-712-7434. And now, here's your host, Rico Basso.
Welcome back to Bridge Bible Talk. I'm your host, Rico Basso, live in the studio with me today, Pastor Robert Baltodano. And we're answering your Bible questions or any question relating to the Christian faith. So get on the phone, give us a call. 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. And also don't forget, you can ask us your questions on our social media platforms, on Facebook and YouTube. Drop them in the questions, and we will answer your questions live on the air. So we're going to go right out to the lines, Pastor Robert, and we're going to go out to Fort Lauderdale, Florida, to Genesis. Genesis, you're on the air.
Hey, how are you guys today?
Good, how you doing?
Doing good, Genesis.
Good, good. I had a question. I also believe that salvation cannot be lost, but as of lately, I've been reading Romans, and I was reading Romans 11, chapter 11, verse 22nd, where it says something about the engrafted olive tree and how they have to be careful because just like the original olive tree, they can be uprooted, something like that. And it got me a little confused when it came to like salvation and all that. Can you guys explain or help me understand that part a little bit better?
Mm. Absolutely. That's a good verse. And you got to keep in mind, too, that Romans chapter 10, Romans chapter 11, you know, Paul is warning the Gentile Christians not to be ignorant, right, when it comes to pride and all of that and their place in God's family. And it's basically referring to, you know, he's making a difference in the Jewish people who have been pruned by God and the Gentile Christians who have been added, you know, by faith in Christ. So the Jewish branches that you're talking about here were pruned, were taken off because of their refusal to believe. As you remember, the first generation didn't make it through. The second generation were the ones. The Gentile Christians were added because they believed. And faith in Christ is the difference that he's making here, the contrast, that is, that he's making in Romans chapter 11. And so Paul writes that if God was willing to break off the natural branches, those Jewish people who were genetic, you know, descendants of Abraham, he certainly won't spare Gentiles who refuse to believe in Christ. So faith in Christ is their only hope of remaining connected to the tree. And that's kind of like the perspective that Paul is giving about the Gentiles versus the Jewish people.
Does that help you out there?
Yes. So in the end, it turns out to be like the promise of salvation would be caught off, like could be caught off just like it was caught off with that initial generation of Israelites.
Exactly, because Israel hardened their hearts in unbelief, right? And even when Jesus came on the scene, even after that, they still denied Christ. They didn't embrace him as their Messiah. And so it is to make room on God's figurative olive tree for Gentile Christians. The old branches of unbelieving Jews have been broken off for now, and the new branches have been grafted in to the roots. So salvation has become like an opening to Gentiles, to non-Christians like us, right? I'm not a Jewish person. And so we have been grafted there. We have the same inheritance as Israel. And so when it comes to salvation, even Paul says in Galatians that there's neither Greek, Jew, nor Gentile, but we're all one in Christ now. So that's the big picture that Paul himself is making there with Israel.
Awesome. Thank you so much, guys. God bless you all.
All right. Good reading, though.
God bless. Yeah, it's a good it's a good question. This is stuff that, you know, you really try to, you got to get down into the weeds and look into deeply.
And one of the things that we were talking earlier, replacement theology says that the church has replaced Israel. And nowhere in the Bible do you see that, right? Mm-hmm. Even Paul says, even in Romans chapter 11, has God casted away his people? He says, absolutely not.
No. Yeah.
And he prays, he says, I wish they were saved, but God will deal with them more time.
Right, and we believe, you know, that during the tribulation period, God is going to, you know, call the Jews one final time into repentance to, to be born again, essentially.
Right.
So that's a great call there, Genesis. Thank you. We're going to go out to Idaho Falls, Idaho. Jenny, you're on the air.
Hi.
Hi, Jenny.
My name is Jenny. I've got a couple of questions, and I've tried to talk to locals around here as far as churches to find an answer.
Okay.
Okay. One was, I just heard you guys do an answer to somebody who was walking away from Christ or losing your faith or losing your place in God. Now, my question is, isn't there, if you ask God for forgiveness of that, for walking away, would you be able to get your salvation back? Is the first one. And the second one is, I've had, between the last 2 years, I've had a lot of my family members pass away, and one was more tragic than the other because she took her own life. In a vehicle accident. Now, when I picked up the Bible because I was scared and my faith was shaken, I don't remember where I was reading this, but it was talking about, in, from what I was understanding, something about a sin of God, which was taking his word into my own image as a human being, that made me scared of even picking up the Bible because I didn't want to be somebody looked at by God, mistaking what he was saying and putting my own interpretation or image into his word. And I can't remember where I seen it, but it was in my Bible. I understood it.
I don't remember, at least in the way you described it, a passage like that. But to go back to your first question, though, and then you asked if you come back, do you get your salvation back? I think that was the whole point that we were making with the other caller, was as far as losing versus, you know, backsliding and walking away from Christ, you know, if it's a season or whatnot, like the prodigal son. You know, the prodigal son, when he left his father's place, he went out for the glitter of the world. And it wasn't until he came to his spiritual senses that, man, I had it all there with my dad, and he's there eating with the pigs, right, food. And that got him back. And he was always a son. He never stopped being a son. And so a person who walks away from Christ for whatever reason, if it's a tragedy, if it's a situation at home, whatever, sometimes, you know, believers go through a hard time in life, and they kind of, I wouldn't say flatline spiritually, but they really go pretty low. If they come back through repentance and realizing, wow, you know, what am I doing here? The Lord always takes us back, but it's not that you get your salvation back. You've always been saved. The Holy Spirit's with you. And so that's what would happen on that end. So that's your first question. The other one, I don't know. Do you know any other verses?
The only verse I was looking and thinking of was in 2 Peter, where it says, knowing that there's no prophecy of scriptures of private interpretation. And then the rest of 2 Peter, you know, he goes on to talk about false teachers. There's the verse in Revelation, you know, that talks about not adding or taking away from the book, or lest you'll receive the plagues. That you find in here, but as far as that goes, Jenny, you know, the important part about reading it's not enough just to read the Bible. You got to read it correctly, and so, you know, our job is to interpret, and, you know, sometimes you might not interpret everything, you know, correctly. There's positions that we hold that, you know, we one day, not major ones, but, you know, something minor perhaps that. Yeah, I might look at it and be like, oh, you know what? I was a little off on this. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that verses like that are aimed at trying to induce fear in you to the point where you won't read, but rather it's supposed to kind of remind you, like, hey, you know, especially with the no private interpretation or adding or taking away, you know, interpret this book and these letters as faithfully with all the resources and all of the capabilities that you possibly can. You know, be careful to interpret rather than, you know, fear to the point where you won't even read. You know, you don't want to get into that space either. So, Jenny, did that answer both your questions there? Jenny, did we lose you?
Jenny, you there? I think we might have lost Jenny.
All right. But either way, you know, Pastor Robert, it is important, you know, it's important to read the Bible, to interpret the Bible, you know, and I think that, you know, you never want to get into a place where you're afraid to read.
Right.
Just because you might not know, you know, if you can hammer down a position or get into a comfortable spot where, you know, you feel like you're doing something, an injustice to the interpretation. It's a good call there, Jenny, and, you know, praying for you. And again, you know, you can't walk away. You can't, you know, obtain your salvation, you know, after, quote unquote, walking away, because it was if you come back, if you repent truly, you know, and you believed and you really were saved before, you never lost it.
Yeah.
You know, you were in rebellion.
Right.
This is Bridge Bible Talk. We are live in the studio, 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434, and we are answering any question that you might have about the Bible or the Christian faith. We're going to go out to Jackson, New Jersey, to Rich. Rich, you're on the air. Rich, are you there?
Might have put us on hold. So we could read his question,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, we could see it.
It's white Jewish people are God. Why? What's it? Wait.
Why the Jewish people?
Thank you. Are right. God's people? Why don't they believe in Jesus?
So if the Jews are God's people, how come they're not?
Yeah, it's you know,
followers of Christ.
Well, there are Jewish people that are being saved today, so we can't say that no Jewish person is recognizing Jesus as Messiah. I mean, we have some here in our fellowship, our church, who are Messianic Jews, and they're believers in Christ, and so. When it comes to them as a nation, I mean, even Paul talks a lot about this in Romans chapter 11, that there's a blindness that has been, I guess, laid upon them at this moment. But God has a remnant that will come to faith in Christ. And so you have in Revelation, there's 144,000. There are witnesses there that God is going to unleash to bring the gospel during that crazy time. But I don't know, any other Bible verses that come to your mind?
I just think what you just mentioned, though, there are Jewish people that are getting saved. Mm-hmm. And because when you use the term, when you use that, like Jewish people, when you say Jewish people, there's a lot more that comes with that package term than just, you know, it's an ethnic group. It's also a religious group tied into one. That's true. Very unique, you know, people group. And mm-hmm. so you have people that are born, you know, I guess you could say, you know, ethnically or genetically, you know, if you will, Jewish, mm-hmm. right? Just like I'm Italian.
Right.
They're born Jewish, but they may have converted to become Christian. Mm-hmm. So if it's in that sense, then of course we see it all the time. Mm-hmm. But the actual religious group or the religious element of that, you know, like we said before, during the period of the tribulation, we believe that God is going to but God is going to call the Jewish people, mm-hmm. you know, to himself. And fulfill the rest of the promises that he laid out in
That's
the Old
right.
Testament. So, yeah. Rich, one last chance. You there? All right. Well, I think we answered your question there. hopefully. God bless. And thanks for calling. 888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. We're going to go out to some of our email questions. Tatiana from New York, she writes to us and says, the Bible says that true worshipers should worship in spirit and truth. How do we worship in spirit? Because sometimes I feel like I study the Bible with intellect.
Hmm.
That's an interesting question there. Pastor Robert, how would you answer that?
So this came from the story of the woman at the well, mm-hmm. the Samaritan woman. And this question was of where proper worship should occur. So it was on location, Mount Gerizim or the Temple of Jerusalem is pretty much what the question was. Rather than taking the bait, Jesus clarifies that true worship of God is not tied to a location, but to the intent of one's heart, the spirit, and in truth. Obviously, you worship in truth based on what Jesus said. That's how we worship him. We don't worship him without that truth. And so that's what it means. I mean, God is a God of reason. He's given us an intellect. And so we use that as well. Obviously, we're not going to just throw out the window our intellect when it comes to that. We need that because we need to know the truth. And so studying the Bible with our minds and understanding, because the Lord also says to love him and to worship him with, you know, all of our mind, strength, heart, soul. So all of those faculties, well, I can't even say
faculties.
Words today. Thank
That's
you. Thank you, bro. is what we are called to use to worship him, to study him, and to get to know him. That's our experience in this life.
Yeah. And I don't think there needs to be a neglect or a caution that you use your intellect to worship God. I mean, mm-hmm. like you said, you've got all these faculties that God's blessed us with. There's got to be a good balance. A good balance, you know, especially when you're talking about like emotion, you know, there's got to be a good balance in there. Otherwise, you know, if you can't produce some sort of emotion when you're using your intellect to worship or study, you know, something's a little off.
Yeah.
You know, you should be able to, you know, be excited or to experience actual joy and mm-hmm. happiness, you know, when you're worshiping or when you're studying the Bible. You know,
yeah.
it should be there. Not, it doesn't have to be there all the time.
Right.
But
and in fact, I think it was A.W. Tozer. I may be wrong on this, but that he's the one that I think he wrote a book, The Knowledge of the Holy One.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in there, I believe, or in another work that he wrote where he's talking about our knowledge of God and, you know, using our minds to study and to understand him should lead us to proper worship.
That's right.
Right. Because sometimes we're led to worship God with the wrong understanding of who he is.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's important for us. You know, a lot of our great minds in the Christian faith, right? 100 years ago, you know, 200 years ago, whatever, you know, some of them that came out were strong intellectual men, but were also men who led others to worship. And when you get to know the Bible and you get to know God, you do have a proper way of worshiping him because you worship him according to spirit and truth.
That's right. And that brings back to something I said earlier, something that my professor says is, you know, it's not enough to read the Bible. You have to read it correctly.
That's right.
And that's important.
It is.
888-712-7434. That's 888-712-7434. We are here live in the studio with Pastor Robert Baltodano answering any question that you might have about the Bible or the Christian faith. So give us a call. 888-712-7434. 888-712-7434. 712-7434. Lori from Brick, New Jersey asks us a question through email. And this is an experience that she had relating to healing. She said a friend had cancer and recently had been attending healing sessions where a priest had put hands on people and then murmured something under his breath and put his hands on the person's head. And they seemed to have fallen unconscious for a small bit of time. And her husband attended one of these sessions skeptically. And when it was done, he said that he had felt dizzy and fought off feelings taking over him. What do you make of this, Pastor Robert?
You know, what comes to mind is that First John passage, I believe it's verse 4, test the spirits whether they're of God. I mean, what is he murmuring under his breath? That's what I would ask. I say, hey, what, can you tell me your formula? What are you saying, right? I mean, I don't want to have somebody pray over me and they're saying things like that. But this is just very mystical. Yeah. I wouldn't use this as a practice. You know, it's not biblical, especially the way he felt dizzy and whatnot, fought off feelings. I don't know. All of that stuff is all very subjective as well. There's nothing objective about this. And so you want to use scripture to really give you the basis for practices like this. So I'd say stay away from it.
I agree. And, you know, I think that when you hear something like this too, and even when you're there, perhaps the emotion of the moment could really kind of overtake you. You know, you could have got dizzy for any number of reasons. Mm-hmm. Doesn't have to necessarily
could have been nervous, anxiety.
Exactly. You're in a spot where you don't know really what's going on. And so, you know, you have maybe a little bit of a, you know, episode or something.
Right.
You got to be careful with stuff like that. Be wise. Patricia also sends us an email. And here's a good one, Pastor Robert. I would like to know what to tell a Christian family member that has accepted the flat earth theory. Can you give me some Bible verses to help out?
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Flat earth theory, not flathead, right?
Flat earth.
Okay. you know, there's verses, but here's the thing, you know, we'll give out some verses that some of those who believe in the flat earth theory will debunk those as well. But I mean, there's so many verses that you can look at that teaches that the earth is not flat. Obviously, they use a lot of the verses to teach against it. But some of them that come to my mind, I'm trying to think here offhand. I'm looking through some of my Bible verses here about this. You have anything in mind?
I just always think of the one where it says that he sits upon the circle of the earth. You know, it's made evident in a couple different scriptures. You know, the Bible is not a science book. Its intention is not to record these things. But when they do record these things and when these things are talked about, they're said with perfect accuracy and truth. So, you know, I don't know what verses particularly these people would point to, you know, say that the earth is flat. You know, there's a lot of language in the Bible where it's pictorial.
Well, like the four corners of the earth.
Right.
Right. That's one of the verses that you find where God says things like that, Revelation 20, verse 8. But other than that, I mean, anything beyond that, again, it's a sphere. It's round. It's... You know, we have pictures, right, of a giant blueberry. but again, I mean, I don't get into those arguments because they really don't do anything but just they become heated. And, you know, we just got to focus on the gospel. It's not going to change anything. It's if that's what you believe, you know, as long as you believe in Jesus Christ as the only way to God and that he's God in the flesh that came here to save us from our sins and that God is the creator. You know, you gotta believe in those essentials.
One of the things I'd encountered somebody who had believed this way, and you know, I don't think that they're ill intent. I don't think it's malice in a sense. You know, the thing that caught my attention most was that in order to land on this idea that the earth was flat, was that you had to really, you know, look deeper into the scriptures, mm-hmm. and you know, and God would reveal it to you. Yeah, at that point, I'm out.
Yeah.
I don't know what... At that point, I'm out. And so, you know, not that there was any validity to it in the beginning, but once you need some sort of guru or some sort of experience in order to reveal something to you that's not clearly there,
right.
I'm out.
Yeah. I found a few verses here. I mean, I could give these out as I'm looking here. Isaiah 40, verse 22 cites the circle of the earth. We have a reference also, I believe it's in Proverbs 8:27, The Earth is circle. It's like a ball-shaped Earth. And so that's where, you know, the proponents of flat Earth, you know, will try to persuade us with Psalm 104, verse 5. But you know what? Where you can really get good information is either answersingenesis.org. They have amazing articles on this. And also the ICR, which is the Institution of Creation and Research. Those are two sites that I would say go for them, you know. Jason Lyle. He's another he's an astrophysicist, but he does talk about the flat Earth theory. So those are three creationists that could easily give you more information on that if you're listening.
Answers in Genesis put out a rather lengthy article. I think it was about a year ago. And again, you could find it on their website. They really do a fantastic job at breaking down why this is something that, because it was, I think, I mean, now it's pretty big, but about a year ago, this was everywhere.
Yeah.
You know, you had professional basketball players talking about it. You had celebrities that go along with it. But Answers in Genesis, absolutely fantastic resource. Mm-hmm. You know, we always bring up anything related to creation or anything like that, like you mentioned. That's the place that you'd want to go to for that. And, you know, anytime that you see these theories or fads, you know, is it a part of the gospel? Is it enhancing the gospel? Does it magnify Christ? I don't think so. And, you know, if anything, it just kind of causes a little bit of stir amongst believers. So that's all the time that we have for today. Thanks for listening. Thank you for calling in. If we didn't get to your call today, give us a call back tomorrow. We're back again in the studio live. But in the meantime, keep reading your Bibles. Keep looking to the Lord. Keep looking up. God bless you. We love you. And we'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you for listening to Bridge Bible Talk. For past programs, go to Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and tune in. For questions and comments for the pastors, email them at questions@bbtlive.org. Join us again, same time and same station, for another broadcast of Bridge Bible Talk.